Welcome back to the show. John Deaton debate crushing a Senator Elizabeth Warren like you won't believe. And Ripple Swell is off the hook. Somebody roll that beautiful intro.
Digital Perspectives with Brad Kimes. Come on in.
Welcome back to the show. You can follow us on Twitter, YouTube, and digperspectives.com for exclusive content. Right now, $2.44 trillion market cap for crypto. The market is up 1.3. 67,900 plus for Bitcoin, 2,600 plus for Ethereum, 119 billion plus for Tether, USDC 34 billion plus, XRP number 7 spots 54 cents. We're up 1.5 on the 24, and we're up 2.3 on the 7-day. Range of price is between 53 and 54 cents. Pretty normal range. We'll keep an eye on it. Take a look at this right quick here. This is from LinkTube, but listen to this.
Is Ripple about to shake up the crypto world with its new coin? They just unveiled RLUSD, a US dollar-backed stablecoin, fully reserved with real assets. Designed for transparency and stability, it's currently being tested on the XRP Ledger and Ethereum networks. Ripple reports that the coin is operationally ready and is collaborating with leading exchanges to prepare for a major release. The only hurdle? Approval from US regulators. Ripple's CEO, Brad Garlinghouse, anticipates the coin could launch weeks away, not months. What are your thoughts on Ripple's venture into the $170 billion stablecoin market?
Pretty remarkable. And to say that we're waiting for regulatory approval is a good thing because there's so many regulators at Swell right now. We're going to get into it in a minute. First, we need to take a look at this. Who won the debate with Senator Warren and John Deaton? A resounding 96 plus percent said John Deaton did. And I want to go ahead and say that that number is actually a little higher. Okay, especially in Massachusetts. But let's get into this. You need to see this. By the way, XRP came up in this debate, but listen to this clip right here. This is remarkable. John Deaton was on fire and dismantled her every turn they came around. Take a listen.
I can't help it. Let me finish, please. Let me finish. I can't help it when she goes to ban an entire industry that they're motivated against her because they see a viable candidate.
She had tried to beat him up about having crypto donations and crypto supporters, and that is exactly what his response to that was to her, and it just absolutely smacked everyone in the face the way he said it. Check it out again.
I can't help it. Let me finish, please. Let me finish. I can't help it when she goes to ban an entire industry that they're motivated against her because they see a viable candidate. But listen, the rules are already there. Senator Warren, you notice she didn't answer the question about those rape victims. You know, you can't call yourself a absolute warrior for women if you only select the women you're willing to protect.
Now she's going to deflect and go back to a question that was asked earlier about banks. And she sounds like she's senile or onset of dementia or something. She refuses to answer the fact that John Deaton just called her out for not representing the women who were harmed in Hump Island. You know what I'm talking about. The J.E. Island, right? That guy, his island. And she's never said a word about it. And we know a lot of that went on right up in her state. We know that J.E. donated money and was very interested in Bitcoin to MIT in Massachusetts. Keep listening.
You know, I really don't understand this charge, and I don't know what you're talking about here.
Everyone else understands
it. I have pushed on the banks and tried to get more regulation over the banks and tried to hold the banks accountable every single time they step out of line. Now, I get it. They're big and they're powerful. Of course, I don't take my money from the banking industry. I take my money from the people who want to support this campaign. What I don't hear you talking about is what exactly do the crypto folks expect to get by funding 90%
of your campaign? You want to know something? Everyone out there, I sued the government because the SEC had done something really bad to small retail investors, and a lifelong Democratic judge agreed with me. I did it all pro bono, and this token XRP was called legal because of my work. I won Lawyer of the Year, Consumer Advocate of the Year, Defender of Freedom Award because I did it for free. And guess what? last week, that crypto billionaire that she's talking about that has supported me just donated millions of this XRP token to Vice President Harris' campaign. If I didn't do what I did, sue the SEC on behalf of small retail investors, that donation to your candidate of choice, Senator, would not have happened. So, Madam Vice President, if you're watching, you're welcome.
God almighty. Boy, I tell you what, don't you get yourself hung up with John Deaton, because you see what happens. Listen to this one.
But here's the thing. Senator Warren lives in this hyper-partisan political world where she's defined by party. You notice it's Democrats are great, Republicans are bad. I got news for you, Senator. All of you suck in Congress, all of you. It's a broken system. I'm disrupting that system. Senator Warren worries about control. When she was asked, what's wrong with John Deaton's policies? You know what she said? Oh, the crypto people like him. Then the person said, well, wait a minute, is that it? She goes, no, we want to not lose control of the Senate. This is the point. Is she worried more about the Neshoba customers and nurses and doctors, okay, and the carny nurses and doctors and patients and the Amazon employees that were going to buy iRobot, if she worried about them the way she worries about control, then Massachusetts would be far better.
Okay, my goodness, it was a masterclass, and you could tell all night Senator Warren just wanted it to be over. I mean, she would try to make these ridiculous pivots and deflections. It was quite embarrassing for her, as it should be. She's been feckless for the state of Massachusetts and the good people there. Now let's switch gears and go to this. It's Ripple Swell. And you know what? Rob Cunningham is an OG in this space, and he got to connect with all the other OGs. Look at him. Brad Garlinghouse, Stuart Alderotti, you got Jake Claver, Bill Stylin, you got the one and only Rafe Wentez, you see it all, James Wallace, you got Michael Arrington in the mix, they're all there. I know it was a great time, and I'm so happy that he got to go. Here's what it looked like at the end, at the poolside here. You can see what the big party was. Look at that with the Ripple logo floating in the pool. And then apparently they had a ballet. They had water ballet going on there. I don't know how that turned out. I'd be excited to hear everybody talk about that. But you know what? Ripple puts these events on every year, and it is absolutely mind-blowing. And as someone who certainly understands what it takes to put on a conference, my hat is off to everyone at Ripple for what they've done. I can tell from even being at home that it never stops with Ripple. The level of class and tact that they put to everything that they do is always visible. It's always visible. You don't have to be there to see it. Let's get into this. It's Monica Long, the president of Ripple, speaking and opening up Swell. Take a listen to this.
In our industry, we think the headline of 2024, it has been the biggest year of institutional adoption for digital assets and blockchain that we've seen to date. And we think this has been driven by three trends. Momentum for global regulatory clarity. Crypto getting validation from Wall Street as a bona fide asset class. Tokenization of real-world assets. And we think this is just the tip of the iceberg. We know from working with financial institutions for many years that what they want is a one-stop shop that provides secure and compliant digital asset infrastructure. And that's what we do.
No doubt about it. And let's see what this clip. This is Brad Garlinghouse saying, kicking off Ripple Swell with a bang, real USD has been nearly a year in the making. And with our trusted exchange partners that we covered yesterday and market makers and advisory board, real USD is set to become the gold standard for enterprise-grade stablecoins built on trust, liquidity, and compliance. Let's keep going here. They sat down with the one and only Adrian Harris from the New York Department of Financial Services. Uh-huh. And they need that approval to get that stablecoin going. And let's look at this. This is the FDIC, former FDIC Sheila Bair, who, don't forget, by the way, was voted twice as the second most powerful woman in the world. And she's talking about regulation and other things with Monica Long. Take a listen.
What are other ways that the private sector can work with the public sector to help create that clarity?
The crypto industry needs to understand what the regulators' objectives are, what their concerns are. The current structure doesn't work Because it's not so heavily intermediated. You don't have the same gatekeepers that you have with the banks or the brokerages or the centralized clearing and settlement systems. It's a promise of new ways of doing business, and the issues are the same, but the structure needs to be different. The challenge is to adapt and learn from our current regulatory structure about how to address this risk and let the positive innovations flourish.
And I believe that's why all of those regulators are there, so they can help clear the path so innovation can flourish. I really do believe that. Again, Sheila Bair from the FDIC, Adrian Harris from, as you know, NYDFS. Now let's listen to this. James Wallace and Graham Rodford from Archax discuss how the growth of real-world asset tokenization is enabling new use cases for digital assets. And isn't this where the world is going? And isn't this like one of the next big phases to happen? The tokenization of everything in the traditional finance market? Of course it is.
What are your thoughts on the technology, you know, aspect of that, and bringing on things like, you know, CSDs into the equation? How do you make these things coexist, but how do you accelerate so you get more benefit?
Yeah, that's probably where I'm a bit more bullish on the adoption of these assets. I mean, we think every asset's going to be on chain. This technology benefits the issuer, the infrastructure, the investor for numerous reasons. So it's inevitable that this is coming. And you mentioned central securities depositories. And for those that don't know, like DTCC, Euroclear, they're kind of the books and records for a lot of publicly traded securities, and every single one of them, Euroclear, Clearstream, DTCC, these guys are looking at tokenization.
And those are the biggest holders of liquidity, the clearing houses, right? In the quadrillions. If you want to debate the number, go look at the DTCC. They said over $2 quadrillion a year. That's who he's talking about. So this is where I believe that flip the switch notion starts to come from, right? And in fact, check this out. Looking at what's been happening, look at this. 18 more real USD minted at the real USD treasury on Etherscan. We know that real USD, when it launches, is going to launch on Ethereum and the XRP ledger. Keep that in mind. Now, there will be those who don't want to admit it, but when I keep seeing all of this large amounts being minted and tested, I can't help but think, but this is what it looks like, and they're about to flip the switch. That's what that looks like to me. Let's keep going. And speaking of RLUSD, here's Uphold's Nancy Beaton. And then we have Ivan Wright from MoonPay. And then Bobby Zagata. And we're going to hear them talking about the real USD, growing stablecoin market. This is where we're going, ladies and gentlemen. Check it out.
The use and adoption of stablecoins within the Uphold platform and how you see that potentially changing.
I do think stablecoins are the killer use case. You know, they are screaming utility. They're lower cost and they're just rapid settlement. It's instant. About 90% of all crypto transactions involve some sort of stablecoin in that transaction. So I think you'll see a lot more on the retail side, the easier we make it to make it borderless, easy, fast for people to use.
There you go right there. And remember, Uphold, who Nancy was just speaking and representing there, chief marketing officer, chief revenue officer, she's talking about the stable coins being a huge impact. And what do we know? Ripple and Uphold are partnered so they can serve enterprise-facing companies. You know, I am super excited about where this is getting ready to go, and you're going to love the way we finish here. Listen to this conversation here. Hunter Horsley, CEO of Bitwise Asset Management, and Tim McCourt, the Senior Managing Director and Global Head of Equities Effects at CME Group, and Eric Balkunas, obviously, from Bloomberg. Take a look.
Assume Trump wins and we have a more favorable regulator, because I want to eliminate the variable that Gensler will just say no. So let's just say we have Chairman Hester Peirce. You have your XRP ETF, but do you need futures? So I want you guys to talk about how, where we could go with XRP getting into that mainstream, the futures and the ETF in the next year or two. Let's start with you, because you need the futures first.
Yeah, so I think one thing to mention, right, is we do have an XRP reference rate and a real-time index, which is sort of the first step, I think, in building out this ecosystem we often talk about between ETFs, cash, futures, derivatives, OTC. But in terms of sort of the regulator, we at CME only have Bitcoin and Ether, because that's where we have the regulatory clarity and certainty that we need to bring products to market. But I think in that interim, as we wait for additional clarity, not only on XRP, but additional tokens and coins that are out there, we have now upwards of 50 real-time reference rates. And I think that's key for folks like Bitwise or other product providers, because they can at least then point to it as a fully regulated benchmark. That they can say definitively, this is the value of this asset at this point in the day, and then do things like wrap a creation redemption process around that, or track things like NAV or INAV. So I think the intellectual property and working on the XRP reference rate is great, and we only rolled that out a few months ago. We'll have to continue to work with the regulators on additional futures. But I don't necessarily think they're needed. I think they're immensely helpful for the ETF, but I'd be curious to your views.
Yeah, I mean, the 34 Act doesn't say there must be CME futures in order.
It would be awesome if we did.
Yeah, there were Jeff's working on that. But it's a conversation with the regulator about why you think the market is mature enough and why the product can function effectively. I think we had a great demonstration with the spot products launched this year that the ETFs can and do function effectively, and with the filing, we began a journey of having a conversation and presenting analysis to the SEC on that front. So.
And there you have it. So it's not required, according to SEC law or any law, that you have to have futures before you have a spot ETF. But obviously tradition says that, right, in great regard. But nonetheless, it's not required. However, what do we know? We know that Bitnomial announced that they're going to be a $25 million funding round led by Ripple. The exchange also plans to launch a perpetual futures trading platform for crypto traders in the U.S., including XRP perpetual futures. But that's where the SEC stepped in to sue Bitnomial, right? They're trying to stop it from happening. But that's okay. We're going to win this fight. You saw how many regulators were there. Look, it's not financial advice from me or anyone else. I'm getting super bullish, and I hope you are too. There's a lot more to come today. Keep a lookout for the next video. We'll talk to you soon. Not financial advice from me or anyone else. I'll catch all of you on the next one.